So I would like to thank the organizers, of course, of this seminar, and Anu and everybody else who put this together. And my talk will be less a showcase of artists and artworks dealing with deep time and deep futures. I put some here on the slide already, and there are, of course, many more. But I will take this as a given that we see an increasing amount of artists working in this area. Also within the BioArt Society, we have been working on these topics with programs like Field Notes, Deep Time, or also in Hybrid Matters, which was mentioned already today. And my aim for the presentation is more to explore a background and to lay out my own questions with a few examples, of course, of other artists' work, of my own work, as I'm also working as an artist, and later go more in depth with a follow-up article. So last June, a newly discovered scandium deposit in the municipality of Rautalampi here in Finland, in the Savo area, made the news. Maybe you have picked it up. And it's Europe's largest deposit in size. It's unique in quality worldwide. And it has an estimated value of about 34 billion euros. And scandium is part of a group of 17 elements from the rare earth element sections. And that is used in alloys with aluminium and natural light bulbs. And these rare earth elements, they are exemplary for our contemporary technologically based culture. We know of their significance, but we also know of their shortage in the international commodity markets. And because of their demanding refining process, they also stand for the slow violence, which is a term coined by Rob Nixon, we are exerting on our planet through our material demands. What we see here is rare earthenware, a work by Unknown Fields Division, and it's dealing in artisan sophistication with the ecological dimensions and scales of high-tech waste in rare earth element productions. You see three Chinese-style Ming vases, which are made from the exact amount of toxic waste which they collected from this rare earth mine, related in the manufacture of three objects of technology: the smartphone, the laptop, and also the electric car battery cell. This is another work which is called Harvesting the Rare Earth by Jakob Sikkaremin, and it presents a speculative near future scenario where mining companies are using specifically grown microorganisms and other organisms to harvest rare earth elements from e-waste dumps. What you see here is part of a video he made from one of these e-waste dumps in Africa, where basically the village is growing and living upon the dump. So it's a futuristic science demo based in the now, but also a dystopic illustration of the ecological consequences of our current reality. And the title, Harvesting the Rare Earth, we can also read it differently, like maybe not so literally as the element, but also in a more maybe dark poetic way when we look at from where is harvested. So because then we find the planet Earth itself, a rare earth indeed. It's the only one which is known to us, or at least within our reach. And at hand, last spring we have heard this viral news about TRAPPIST-1, which is a solar system about 40 light years away, which has seven potential planets to host life. But the fastest human-made object, the spacecraft Juno, with a speed of 265,000 kilometers per hour, would need 159,000 years to reach TRAPPIST, and here acceleration and braking is not even included. So for us, this seems like an insurmountable obstacle, but still it is within a similar time frame. We are currently also planning and addressing the future, like for example with the Finnish nuclear waste, permanent nuclear waste storage Onkalo, which is planned to last for the next 100,000 years. So let's this take as a first indicator that within my talk we deal with long time frames during this brief half an hour. So what makes Earth so rare for us is that it is for an unforeseeable future, time, the only planet which is able to host life as we know it, including us humans. Earth provides many materials enriched during deep time, which after we learned to make use of them started to mine. We have the Stone Age, the Bronze Age, the Iron Age. The periodization of the prehistory is based on changes in material culture and technology. And maybe in future histories, books, we will find the Rare Earth Age as the curators of the Rare Earth exhibition in Vienna speculated. So here on this slide, you see an artwork by British artists Reginald Koch and Tour van Baalen, and they formed this piece of artificial ore of copper, aluminium, gold, tantalum out of equipment from a bankrupt company, and it was part of this exhibition. Interestingly, the discovery of rare earth elements in the 18th and 19th century is strongly connected to Scandinavia, after which the element scandium itself was named. Also, elements cerium and lanthanium were found first in the minerals of Bastnäs in Sweden. The elements yttrium, ytterbium, erbium, and terbium are all named after the small village of Ytterby on the island of Växjö, close to Stockholm, which itself gave the name to the element holmium. The element tullium was named after the ancient Greek word for the Scandinavian region, and the element gadolinium at last was named after a Swedish-Finnish geologist, Johan Gadolin, who was the first to separate this oxide, this earth, from the minerals of Ytterby and to the element yttrium. And now we remember him through this mineral, gadolinite, which was found in Ytterby and where these elements were drawn from. So we can use these manifold stories which unfold within harvesting the rare earth to let us guide towards the Anthropocene, a revel of contemporary discourse. It is yet not clear if the term is scientifically useful and when in time and where in the strata it should be anchored to fulfill the scientific requirements for announcing a new geological epoch. However, the term finds a strong resonance in the humanities and in the arts, welcoming for summarizing for many what is wrong with the world, but also under strong critique and scrutiny for its generalization and for its anthropocentrism. But this also leads to a necessary and very helpful deconstruction to dissolve this term. And we can see that reflected in various synonyms which are emerging everywhere to emphasize different aspects and readings of the Anthropocene. And Antti was even referring to the hyper-Anthropocene exactly because of this reason. The ones in red are from academic discourses, and you will maybe recognize many of them. Others I collected in a Facebook survey a year ago and were just made up on the fly to kind of reflect maybe the current kind of relation to this discourse. There is also the Anthropocene by Finnish scholar Jussi Parikka, who wrote this book, The Geology of Media. My favorite one is the Misanthropocene because it points with a dark humor towards that we bury ourselves before we are even dead. And the work behind is from Åsa Stoll, Christina Lundström, Plastic Glomerate, who are also involved with the workshop and in the exhibition here. However, this geologic turn, which we can observe in the humanities and the arts, results from the realization that the human planetary activity has reached a scale that is changing the Earth system itself, and that this change will be readable in the strata of deep geological futures. Myself, I'm specifically interested in this dichotomy between human time perception and understanding time in everyday human life and the time of biological, environmental, and geological processes which we as humans are part of, but which can run on very different time scales. Processes which are immensely short, like the quantum effects in plants during photosynthesis, or up to be unbearable long, like the slow long performance of landscape folding in continental drift. The slide shows one of my works, Polsprung, a series of disastrous test arrangements, as I call this, for witnessing the reversal of the Earth magnetic field. That's the German word Polsprung, describes that, which in average occurs every 800,000 years at the moment, and it is overdue. So there is a little crisis already on the horizon, and it's potentially fatal for our technoculture. So this before mentioned dichotomy arises because we as individuals are currently asked to adjust our way of life or to contribute to projects and measures to secure a future where we will not be part of and for people which we will never know. So I think this is really an interesting point here. It is not a risk to say that most individuals, most of us, lack the foundation on how to discuss and decide and prepare for such deep future matters. So as an artist, my question follows. How can art assist to perform the Anthropocene? What strategies are there to explore the scripts, the plays, the boundary conditions for this performance? What tasks are there? Under what conditions do we start? And what are the outcomes? How can an understanding of deep time lead to an understanding of the present for a livable future? What possible futures await us on a scale from probable to impossible? Let's expand on this a little bit. Deep time essentially means geological time. Earth history from its beginnings as a molten ball of matter until the present. Deep futures do not exist yet. They are a thought vehicle for us to speculate within the possibility space of the future Earth, unfolding during the long time ahead. Futurist Jim Dator proposed four generic futures, human futures, and we heard them also already in our discussion in the morning. So there is the continuation, then there is the collapse, there is the disciplined society, and there is transformation. Probably this is what we imagine where we are heading, or this is like what we like to have, transformation. Modern geology started with James Hutton. He understood that the time of processes which are needed to form and alter landscape around him can't impossibly conform with the back then current idea that the age of the Earth would be 6,000 years, which was derived from biblical scholars. Hutton's theory caught on, but people were unsatisfied with the notion of the unknown and unidentifiable age, which he gave as a conclusion, and the quest for the age of the Earth followed. Charles Darwin claimed 300 million years, Lord Kelvin calculated 20 million years. It was only the discovery that the decay of radioactive isotopes can be used as a clock that people started to measure isotopes in rock, and so in 1907 I think it was already 2.2 billion years, between 400 million years and 2.2 billion, so the range was rather large. But years after years the number climbed then up, and in 1956 Claire Patterson arrived at the number of 4.6 billion years, and this is also where we are still now, which is the accepted age for our planet. The oldest solid material known are zircons. I'm missing a slide here, or it's somewhere else, which are part of younger sediments. There are, of course, also non-Western deep times in mythologies, stories, religion, and sciences of other cultures, some bygone, some still with us. The longest timeline I could find was the Mayas, with they date back creation 24 trillion years, so that's really long. And interestingly, Hindu cosmology is the closest to ours. They also count basically the universe in time spans relating to billions of years. And what about the rock under our feet? Helsinki is built on rock roughly 1.8, 1.9 billion years old. During this era, probably the first eukaryotic cells, which are basically the form of life we are also based on, appeared. And also during this era, the earliest global scale continent collision belts developed. And when you now go to Koli and you go on top of the hill, then you can see the remains of such a belt, and you stand on the stump of a mountain range which is called the Karelits, which was thought to be like 5 kilometers high. Yeah. In deep time, in the past, Helsinki about 250 million years ago was maybe believed to be in the area of current North Africa, and the same time into the future, we might be somewhere on the north shore of the Caspian Sea in Kazakhstan. So there is some movement happening. And about the, okay, that was the Zircon slide. Quickly, now we go here. About the assumed end of our planet, in about 4.8 billion years, the sun will start to expand. When its hydrogen core is exhausted, a loss of mass will change the orbit of the Earth. And additional processes will likely having the planet swallowed up within the sun's sphere, which will then slightly increase its metal content by 0.01%. This is then the legacy. However, life as we know it will most likely not find favorable conditions after the next 1 to 2 billion years. But who knows if we make it there. Also, this assumption does not take into account possible random events like asteroids hitting the Earth, which happened in the past. If we look at the timeline, we can see that life and its records seem to be a fantastic marker for Earth's dynamic history. I don't think that there have been less catastrophic events before that, like before 550 billion years, but only since complex life and its geological records exist, it is just easier for us to relate to these events. However, it will play out that geologic future record depends on a geologic past, which we currently make use of. And within the strata of our Earth, we find the substances, as I already pointed out, which provide us with our energetic and material foundations. Of biogenic origin are the carbons and hydrocarbons of petrol, gas and coal, the fossil which fueled human ascent, as laid out in the petrophilosophy of Thierry Vardin's book, Energy and Experience. Please check that out, you can download it. And which we now lay down again, these carbons, robbed of the energy, onto the current layers of the Earth and shifting the past into the present. Another energizer of our civilization is uranium. And interestingly, the genesis of uranium deposits is also well linked with the biosphere. The great oxidation event, like 2.3 billion years ago, which was the shift from anaerobic to oxygen metabolizing life, which in itself was the biggest mass extinction of life the planet has seen, set free the oxygen to oxidize the finely dispersed uranium, and by that made it water soluble, which was then a precondition for further enrichments to the deposits we now mine. Life, rocks, elements, atoms, all a one big systems. We live off previous life, showing that within big history, the division between the organic and inorganic becomes blurry and intertwined. It shows that life as such, and us in particular, are part of the Earth system and in no way special or separable. And if you want to briefly meditate in deep time, then let's pause for a second and imagine that every single atom which makes up your body was once part of or produced by an exploding star. But let's head back into the present in relation to deep futures and again to the nuclear. An example for a practical deep future challenge is how to communicate a nuclear waste storage site into the future. The Finnish government has decided that upon closure of Onkalo in about 120 years, the information of its existence and context should be communicated to the future generations. How to develop a marker which is able to serve as a warning for future generations and that something toxic and dangerous is buried and to stay away from such a place. We cannot assume that written language will stay the same with spoken language. We cannot assume that the surface conditions be even stable over short times, and we also have an assumption that within the next 30,000 years a next ice age will be on the place where Onkalo stands at the moment, if not global warming prevents that from happening. So Onkalo is engineered for the next 100,000 years. And proposals range from establishing an atomic priesthood, again, references to religion, seems to be something of a topic today, to an artificial landscape invoking terror up to shrine line architectures with pictograms. And the current state for now is that it's each generation's responsibility to give the message further, however they will do that. Also interesting to point out is the transdisciplinarity of the group and practitioners who have been involved in creating proposals around this new field of nuclear semiotics, how it's called. It's engineers, anthropologists, nuclear physicists, behavioral scientists, linguists, archaeologists, artists, architects, designers, geologists, and whatnot. Yeah? And they have been together in workshops as early as 1981, also in the Human Interference Task Force on behalf of the U.S. Department of Energy and the Bechtel Corporation, which is a building corporation. One of those early proposals came to the conclusion that if there are humans, there will also still be cats. And out came the RayCat solution. Sounds really fabulous, the RayCat solution. Step one, engineer cats that change color in response to radiation. Step two, create the culture, legend, history that if your cat changes color, you should move someplace else. And the idea resurfaced recently. There is a website, check it out, raycatsolutions.com. So nuclear matters are also one of my artistic own interests and one of my works, Inheritance, which I produced in collaboration with jewelry artist Marie Keto, also deals with what will we leave behind in relation to deep futures. Inheritance consists of a set of precious but radioactive jewelry artifacts, a family heirloom, and because family jewelry exists in many cultures and serves both to form and bind family affiliations, but also to distribute wealth and identity into the future. So the story with the jewelry goes that nobody remembers why it was radioactive in the first place, but the jewelry is unwearable for deep futures and is in the care of the family. The jewelry is stored in a durable concrete container together with some artifacts and items for measuring the remaining radioactivity, and each time it is handed over from one generation to the next, then the family performs together, the elder with the younger, the ritual of measurement to determine if the jewelry can finally be brought in use to fulfill its waiting promise or if it has to be stored away again for a next attempt until the following generation. I cannot see. 5 minutes. That's good. So how shall we as artists deal with these scales and scopes? What are possible strategies? We can downsample and scale this vastness and inhuman complexities to suit human experience and try in such a manner to create an understanding for the underlying processes. But if we want to assist in performing the Anthropocene, we might need to take the opposite route, what Benjamin Breton calls the weaving of long circuits. With human enterprises like Onkalo or Earth system changes like climate change in mind, we can say that if art can assist to perform the Anthropocene, it is not because of bringing these uncanny processes into our sensory comfort zones. The weaving of long circuits should head in the opposite direction, to scale art to the scope of the real instead of downsampling reality towards the digestible, to quote Breton directly. We can read this in many ways, like as to fully work and engage with material realities to instigate processes and to let them work out in their own time and scale, from femtoseconds to billions of years, or strategies to research and test possibilities to enable things to articulate themselves and to throw ourselves into the middle of it all. Of course, it's not a question of either or, and it would be also silly to draw a line here. I think plurality of approaches is really what we need to work out and also accept. I could go on and tell about hunting scenes from the distant past and also from the close past. I could tell you about the Carbon Liberation Front, which with its cynical slogan, "Thriving is recycling," probably involuntarily dethrones Anthropos in our scene, as it might just turn out to be a minor episode of the redistribution of molecules on our rare earth. But still, this doesn't give us really peace, and we heard that already in the beginning. So performing the Anthropocene means also staying with the trouble, to quote Donna Haraway, and read in her book with the same name, The Camille Stories. It means essentially the weaving of long circuits. Thank you.